Hey y'all, Stacy Wells here, Stacy Wells Artistry. I'm just fooling around out in the garage. I'm fixing a, I told y'all I had other projects I was gonna do. So this is one of them. I'll tell you ahead of time, I'm having all kinds of technical problems today. I couldn't get that stupid tripod to sit right. I was talking about that in the other video. It's a bad design and it doesn't work well. It's real hard for me to not cuss when I talk about it, but I'm trying. Anyway, it won't. It's not a standalone tripod. If you're thinking about doing this, you need a standalone tripod because that thing clamps onto stuff and it doesn't want to stay. And if you move the phone or anything else, it tends to want to snap off of there. It's very frustrating. Makes you want to scream. Definitely makes you cuss. And I try, this is supposed to reduce my stress, not make it worse. So don't get one of those. Get one of those from Amazon, those standalone ones that you can adjust the height and direction with the halo light. I like them better. Those are my favorite kind. And for those of y'all that are new, that's what I try to do on here. I'll just give my little disclaimer. I'm not claiming to know how to do all of this stuff. I'm just telling you how I do it. And I've been doing it for a long time and I've made a whole lot of mistakes. And I like to tell people about those so they don't have to go and repeat it. If you have questions or comments or anything like that, please leave them. I know I've been on a hiatus and I was late getting to a bunch of y'all, but I'll be back around and get those. Or you can always email me if you need a quicker response at stacywellsartistry@gmail.com. I'll put that in the notes. But you can always email me. I'll get that quicker and I will respond to you because I like people stopping by and telling me what they think or if they have questions or comments or if you know a different way or a better way, please enlighten me. But this is just how I do it. And, some of y'all seem interested in it. So I thought I'd make some more videos, especially with Christmas time. I did a Christmas ball one yesterday and, later on today, I'll show you the results of those. They're dry now and I'll show you how those turned out. But this is going to be long enough all on its own. In fact, it probably won't all fit on one. If it cuts off, I'll make another one starting where it ended up. That tends to happen to me. The phone just will cut off for whatever reason. So if that happens, I'll pick it back up. I am not a tech genius. I do not understand some of the nuances that go along, most of the nuances that go along with that. Anyway, I did do something that I don't usually remember to do. I'm going to tell y'all what paint's in all of this. I've got 7 cups out here. You can't see them yet. I'm going to adjust the camera where you can. There's 7 large cups on this piece of board. And this is not birch like I normally would use if I was doing a big pour painting. If you're doing a large pour painting, you can't use those canvases for it because they're going to sag in the middle with all that paint. And all the paint's going to run to the middle and it's going to be all messed up. If you're doing a large one, I suggest using birch wood. It's light and supposed to be, I've read it's the best one. I don't know. This time I'm doing a little experiment because I didn't want to spend the money that birch wood costs and because I found this particle board stuff and I think it's going to work just as well. It's very light. I sanded it and sand the edges too. Don't forget about the edges and the underlying edge because it'll be kind of sharp and, you know, hard to move around, but definitely sand the edges. If you want the paint to run over the edges when you resin and resin those edges, be sure you sand them because those little gaps and stipples and whatever you want to call them that are on the edges, when you try to resin that, the resin's going to give you a hard time sticking if it's not sanded. It may anyway. I've had that happen. But anyway, it's a good idea to sand all of that. And I like for the paint to run off the side. And then when I do the resin, it's going to cover that edge. And then it looks more natural than painting that a separate color. Although you can do that. It's, to me, sort of difficult to do because inevitably if I'm doing that, my paintbrush is going to slip and I'm going to put a big swatch over the side I don't want painted. Anyway, you can figure that out, but this is the way that I do it. Okay, the first one of these colors that we got here, this is kind of an earth tone board with some blue and crimson in it. And so there's some phthalo blue mixed with Prussian blue. And those are both Master's Touch. And then the it's not really crimson, it's garnet, and it's Deco Art metallics right here. You can buy these next at Hobby Lobby, right next to where the small deco art paints are usually. They're a little bit more pricey, but I love this garnet. It works really well. It's metallic and it's pretty. It does have to be thinned a little bit with water when you're mixing your paints. This gold is the same thing. It's deco art gold. It has to be thinned quite a bit. It gets very thick. Like I said yesterday, any of the metallics are going to be somewhat thicker by their nature because they contain the mica pigments that make them metallic. And those pigments are powder-like substances that go in there, so they're inevitably going to be thicker anyway. And they just depend on how much thicker. And some of the regular paints turn out to be thicker, too, for some reason. Like, for instance, this Viridian Master's Touch is one of my favorite colors. For some reason, this paint is thicker than most regular acrylic paint. I don't know why. Anyway, that's one of the colors. And then I have some Arteza. This is burnt umber. And I mixed that with some Deco Art Rich Espresso. And I did that to give it a little bit more metallic sheen. I also added a little bit of this to it. This is, I can't say exactly what it is. It's a pigment. Guess what? This is some mica flakes pigment. I can't remember the brand, and it's not written on here or it's worn off. But this is kind of coppery color, and it has some kind of diamondy, shimmery flakes in it. Anyway, I put a little bit of that in there and mixed it with that espresso. And then there's the copper, Master's Touch copper, also mixed with a little Deco Art copper and the pigment. And then I didn't want stark white for this one, so I mixed some off-white, and I ran out of it and threw it away, and I don't remember the name, but it's a off-white, and I ran out of it, so I had to mix some titanium white Master's Touch with that, but it came off a cream color. Anyway, and then there's permanent black Master's Touch, we got that, and Liquitex silver, another metallic. So, when I mix these, I'll just go over real quick how I do that. If I need to thin it with water, or if it's a metallic, or if I'm adding any kind of pigment to it, like any kind of powder, you know, mica to it, I'm going to do that first. So I'll just put the paint in the cup and then mix it with that powder or whatever, how much water, and I don't put very much water. Water is your enemy. The reason that I don't use craft paint primarily or a whole lot, if I use this, I only add a little bit of it to one of the other name brand companies like Master's Touch or Arteza or Liquitex or whatever. The reason I do that is because these are filled with more water, and I've read that they have certain additives in them that cause problems. Problems like crazing. Problems like poor cells, problems like flaking and stuff too soon. Of course, that's not going to be a factor if you resin or, you know, put a coat on the outside, but still, I have used them when I first started out primarily, and what is it? Why do you keep coming at me? You're bothering me. I can't concentrate.
What?
What do you need?
Nothing, I'm just putting this on.
Okay. I can't concentrate. Richard, you don't know what I'm doing. Just you don't know what I'm doing. Please let me do it. I'm in the middle of making a video. Do you mind? We can talk about this later. Ugh. Excuse him. I won't, but you can. Anyway, those are our colors, and let me see that got me all caterwampus. Now I gotta go back to think about what I was saying. Yeah, if I'm gonna add water or add other paint to a certain color to change the color of it, I do that first. Before you add glue, before you add Floetrol, before you add anything. And yesterday I went on a big soapbox about why that is, so I'm not gonna do that today. If you wanna know, call and ask me and I'll get on my soapbox again. I just add a little bit of water. I don't ever add a whole lot. The paint needs to be able to move in order to create cells. It has to be able to flow. So it can't be real thick. But yesterday we were doing those balls, and it needs to be thicker for them or else it just runs right off. Now, I like mine thicker than maybe some people do for regular pours as well. I want it to run off the stick, but not just run. I want it to hesitate and kind of drip. Anyway, I talked a lot about that yesterday. If you have questions about that, please message me and I'll go into it in as great a detail as you can stand to listen to. But the next thing I do after adding the water is I add a big old blob of glue. Just that first blob that comes out of the container. And not more than that. On these, I added two blobs because these are big cups. Okay? And there was a lot of paint. More than 3 tablespoons of paint like I added yesterday. So, add, you know, however much paint you like. You ultimately have to experiment with all this and figure out what works for you. I'm just going to tell you what I'm doing. And what works for me. But the best teacher you can have, I think, is experience. And if you find people that you like and you see their results and you're happy with them, then, you know, I have definitely taken, you know, all kinds of direction and advice and hints. And, you know, I mean, if it hadn't, you know, I mean, I talked to lots of people when I first started out doing this. And then what it ultimately came down to is just figuring your own way through it. I have a way I do it. I do not measure. I eyeball quantities because measuring seems more like cooking, which seems more like work, which doesn't translate into why I do this. So it's more of an innate natural process for me. I just kind of organically go at it. And if you need a measurer and somebody that's going to be real detailed about all that, I'm not your gal, but there's lots of people that do that way, and that's fine if that works for them. I just use, you know, I'd say in this there's about 4 tablespoons of paint. I'm not even good at guessing about it. I'll just be honest, I'm not. And then there's those 2 big blobs of glue, and then the Floetrol that fills up the rest of the cup. And then what I do is I put the paint together, I put the water, if any. Okay, that was a phone call. That just interrupted us. It did not stop us. Okay. Anyway, I put the paint, I put the water if I'm going to add any, and I don't add any unless I really have to because I don't like doing it. And then mix all that together. Before you add your Floetrol, mix the glue with the paint. It just makes mixing the rest of it go smoother. I find less blobs and globs and all that kind of stuff. So I mix it some then I add the Floetrol, mix real good, very thoroughly. Be sure that you take into account the landscape of the cup that you have. I was using some yesterday, it had a little lip on the bottom. You gotta be sure you get all that paint out, you know, otherwise it's a bad thing, don't do that. So just keep into account what you're using. I use different cups all the time. I don't have specific ones, and you know, anyway. So I got all these mixed up. When I'm pouring, I tend to pour down the side. Sometimes I'll pour across the top, but for this time I pour just down the side. I don't pour very much at a time because I want a lot of variation between the colors. I want them to move together. If you pour big amounts of one color and then big amounts of another color and big amounts of another color on top of each other, you're going to have more of those colors together and not intertwined, I think. That's been my results. And for this, I want it to be really mixed together. We got all of that done. Treadmill oil. I put it in everything. I put treadmill oil in my colors individually when I mix them at the very end. When I'm done putting that treadmill oil, I put a few drops, maybe a few more. Do not mix that a whole bunch because it will degrade. So just give it a couple of swirls. I know some of you are going to want to go, oh, but it's bubbled up around the edges. I can see it on the top of the paint. Well, don't worry about that. Just give it a few swirls. Resist that urge to stir the hell out of it because it will degrade and it'll be like you never used it. And I tell you, I have seen some very accomplished artists on here that will put that treadmill oil in there and they will just stir the hell out of it. And I don't know why. Because I learned from somebody early on that happens, and from results, I believe it does. So just give it a few stirs, you know, once you put that treadmill oil in. You're done after that with that paint, except I put the treadmill oil in the individual colors. Then when I get my cups here that I'm going to pour from, I put some in the bottom of them for one reason. Well, several reasons, but one reason is if you put that treadmill oil in before you start pouring your paint in, the paint will all come out of the cup better. You don't have a lot of paint left in the cup because the oil and the paint resist each other. And so it will, you know, help you get all your paint out, if that's a factor for you. I don't like wasting stuff. You know, it's expensive. Second thing is, I think it helps to create cells. I know some people that will put some treadmill oil in the middle of their layering. I don't usually do that unless I'm feeling just really OCD, and then maybe I do. But most of the time I don't. But I do put some on the tops of these cups. After I'm done pouring my paint in, I squirt a little on the very top, and you can see that these are already making some cells on the tops of these cups. Now, that's enough of all that. If you want to know more about prep and all that stuff, you know, message me and let me know. And like I said, I'd be happy to go into it with you. I apologize for the camera angle on here. I can't do any better with that thing. I fought with it all morning, and this is the best I can do. And when I start tilting this booger, I don't know what's going to happen. And you know what I think I'm going to do is break right now and make another video of the actual pour, because that's going to take some time, and I'm afraid that thing's going to cut me off, because it always seems to do that when I get to the good part. Okay, well, this is the, I'll just call this intro to big pour or something like that. This board, I can't even tell you exactly the dimensions on it, because I just bought it and had them. I didn't even have them cut this. This is the way it came, these two boards. But it's some kind of particle board. And I did sand it. I did gesso it also. I don't know if I mentioned that. But I always gesso wood or glass or plastic or anything weird like that, because you never know how the paint's going to react with an ungessoed surface. I've just had disasters. So that's what I do. All right, I'm going to break for now. When I come back, we'll pour the paint, see where we go, and we'll wrestle this big booger. It'll be like Ichabod and the whale. All right, guys, I'll see you shortly. Bye-bye.